time. Rick.
By the way, does the meeting call to order?
Let's call a meeting to order.
Okay.
Good? Yeah. Yeah, so let's look over the minutes and just, oh yeah, are you able to take minutes this week? Or this month?
Yeah, I can.
Or do you have your phone for the?
My phone's in the car, if you don't mind.
That would be really cool. You have the app that, or what are you just gonna say that?
I don't know mine is, so my app is.
Is that cool?
Yep.
Alright, great. Right, you know who everyone is and you're calling them, so.
Yep.
Okay, let's look at the minutes and see what we think.
So as the meeting is called, I'll entertain a motion then, and start the meeting.
We, it started.
It has?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, no, we're.
I just wanted to make sure.
We're starting.
For the record.
Uh-huh. Motion and stuff?
I'll make a motion for some.
Alright. Seconds?
A second that motion?
Yeah, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, unanimous minutes. Right on. Let's do some correspondence stuff. We have received a couple things, a town and city flyer, a supply lines, source flyer, and we've received a letter. The New Hampshire DOT is planning the subject highway safety improvement project in Andover, Boscombe, Danbury, Enfield, Franklin, Grafton, Springfield, and Wilmot. The proposed work includes replacing deficient roadside cable barrier and W-beam guardrail with MASH and all sorts of other good stuff. Project limits are on Route 4 in Enfield, Grafton, Danbury, Wilmot, Andover, Boscombe. 4A in Enfield, Grafton, Springfield, Wilmot. 11 in Andover and Route 3 in Boscombe. All proposed work is within the state right of way. We're talking about wetlands being impacted and all appropriate measures. I'm not sure we really have a whole lot to do with this on a regulatory front. Seems like an informational kind of thing. Sounds like they're fixing the highway and they're taking the right steps to do it. So, I don't know. That's it for correspondence. Okay, we had talked about improving our subdivision regulations and I kind of think we should wait to have what ends up being a full board. Whether I mean, maybe if one person's gone, you actually sit and it's five people, I feel like that might be reasonable. With two normal members gone, I kind of feel like we should not necessarily make any big decisions.
I agree.
Are you suggesting this is going to be a short meeting?
Something like that. We,
I'd love a quick upload.
So, I think we should talk about a couple things to put some bugs in our ears and get us, like, thinking about it, but I don't think we should... You know, like, if you have a quorum of even just three people and someone needs an approval, I thought I don't have a problem with that, but, like, long-term board procedural changes, I feel like we ought to at least have most of us here. So, we talked about going through 1 through 6 on the subdivision regulations. I'm not sure that makes good sense to do. But I think looking at some changes that I've made to the application would be valuable. And that's what we all have in front of us. We have the existing voluntary merger applications, we have the existing subdivision application, and we have two proposed, more concise, whittled down equivalents of the subdivision application. And I'll get through that in a moment. This 3 years ago, probably, I made up these applications, and I didn't do the most leak-tight job, but it was kind of shot down. Like, why would we bother changing something that works? And I kind of get that, but also I feel like our existing application is a little bit lengthy and maybe a little too complicated, and most notably has this like random ordinance for regulating mobile home parks, which is not even an ordinance. It is proposed for the town of Grafton. And I just don't know why it's in there. I feel like a mobile home park, it's like kind of understood that there's lot minimums and there have to be the right amount of space for septic designs on those lots. And if a mobile home park can conform to that, then maybe that would be great. And if it can't, well, I don't know if we need to outlaw it entirely. I don't want to discriminate against people wanting a trailer. So
that shouldn't be in there.
It's just not part of
it. If it's not an ordinance, you can't present it as an ordinance.
It's sneaky, right? It's not really.
It shouldn't be in there.
So that eats up a lot of the space of this whole thing. But there's also a bunch of other stuff. So I had originally proposed an application which was the umbrella Grafton Planning Board application. And what that meant is it had checkbox for voluntary merger, it had checkbox for subdivision application, it had checkbox for lot line adjustment. And all of that stuff, I think it was a little overwhelming. And the other thing that is valuable to point out is that a voluntary merger is a legally simplistic procedure compared to a subdivision. In other words, you do not need to notify abutters. You do not need to have a public hearing. In fact, like, you really don't need to do anything except prove that you are the owner of both lots and say that you'd rather they just be one lot. And so this is an existing... It's a pair because, in theory, the applicant fills out one and the planning board fills out the other. And so, I can't even really remember which one's which, to be perfectly honest, but I think it makes sense. The problem with this is that usually the applicant just ends up filling out both, and it becomes unclear which one is which. So it might be valuable for us to like look through it on our own time between now and next meeting and like confirm which of these is to be filled out by the applicant and which one is to be filled out by the board and change them just enough to clarify that. That's the only change that I would suggest on that, and I think otherwise it's a perfectly reasonable application.
Why does the board have to fill out any of it?
I think it's an exercise in making sure that the right numbers are being sent to the registry and that there aren't any tricks like throw you the 20 but give them a 10 afterwards, you know? And I guess if we double check it, it could be considered fine. If we agree that we don't need to fill it out, I love the idea of.
I just don't see why I put the onus on us when we're not the ones merchant property.
Sure, no,
I'm
okay.
I'm all for if you're gonna do something, do it, don't hand it to me to do it.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe we wanna look at these together and figure out if one of them can be scrapped. I don't actually know the history of these, if they are supposed to be of care, or it's possible ones from 2010 and ones from 2015, and we just kind of started the staple together.
And
then
we'll say revised in 2016.
Right, so. Right. Anyhow, let's keep that in mind, that the voluntary merger form is basically fine, but we might want to consider either clarifying that one is for the town to do, or eliminate one of these so it's a single page. So moving to the subdivision application, there has been contention in the board recently, that's in the last 3 or 4 years, that a lot line adjustment is not technically a subdivision. And I've talked to two different municipal lawyers about this, actually gained a very snarky response aimed at Frank and Brian, which was not appreciated by them. I think probably had it. It's actually kind of hilarious. It's not a great way to get things done. Certain members of the Grafton Planning Board have come to the erroneous conclusion that when a property owner is seeking to get approval for a minor lot line adjustment or boundary line agreement, it is unnecessary to provide a butter notification. This whimsical notion is patently contrary to the controlling statute, which he states there. So I agree with this lawyer. It would be nice if he was a little more professional in how he phrased it, but the point made is that when you do a lot line adjustment, it is legally a division of land. It is subject to all of the same laws as a regular old subdivision, with one very clearly specified exception that a public hearing does not need to be held and does not need to be advertised. But you still need to notify abutters. People who have stake in the surroundings need to be made aware in case their pins are getting moved or if there's a mistake or, you know, kind of back to this like, malicious mistake or honest mistake, either one, it gives the opportunity for people to ideally not be busybodies, but just make sure it's done right. So there was a lot of confusion because the lot line adjustments are treated differently, and they used this original plain subdivision form. And I thought it would be perfectly reasonable to make two different applications, one for a real proper subdivision and one for a real lot line adjustment. And the reason I think that having two different ones is valuable is because they do require different things. And when you have one application with a bunch of options, it's not really immediately clear what needs to be listed. For example, like, you don't need to have a public hearing for a lot line adjustment. So if it was part of the subdivision application, it could be erroneously considered to have to hold one, or people wouldn't know what to do or what not to do. And so, I mean, the other example here is the subdivision application has one property owner. A lot line adjustment that by default is very likely to have two or more property owners, because it's two separate properties being manipulated instead of just one. So, and so.
Show what you're choosing to do, whether it's a subdivision or a lot line adjustment.
Because a lot line adjustment, also known as an annexation, is technically a subdivision subject to one exception of not needing to hold a public hearing if no new lots are being created, which I think is kind of redundant, because if new lots are being created, then it's a subdivision. I think this clarifies it for people. I think that, like, if you we don't need to necessarily vote on whether this is appropriate, but we could consider looking at them, offering suggestions. I know that when I did get the other board members to take this slightly seriously in the past, they made the good suggestion that I should have page numbers. And they suggested that there should be two different applications rather than one blanket one. And so that it was productive. The other thing that I don't believe this has is a list of abutters. And so what ends up happening usually is there's just like a big packet of the official mail. Hey, how's it going? It doesn't have a list, so people would like take a stack of all the certified mail abutters notices, and there would just be like a stack attached to it. Very hard to tell like what each one was, and it was often like a kind of a carbon copy scrawl. And I think it's valuable to have all of those lots, you know, listed clearly on the application. I do think that abutters are kind of the key component to a subdivision. If you didn't have abutters, why would you even bother? Like, it's all about someone owns this and someone owns that, and you try to just cooperate with it. So, anyways, I think that's about it. And I tried to do it so it's two pages for the applicant. You know what? I think I did this wrong. I think I stapled one on the crooked. Yeah, I did. If your pages are ordered correctly there, that's good. I stapled one of these in the wrong order. But basically, the applicant fills in the first two pages, and the board fills in the third page. And I think it cuts the back so that you can kind of just make sense of it. It might be valuable to, there are certain requirements for timelines on the abutter notification. It needs to be mailed 10 days before. And to the best of my knowledge, there's different kinds of days. There's like business days, but there's also something known as clear days. And so a clear day is, you have to, you mail it on one day, and then the next day is day one, and you count 10 days, and then the hearing is on the next one. So like there's 10 days between, so that, then actually I'm sure that in the past I've sent stuff out too late. Like, because I'm like, oh, it's like, you know, 72 hours or whatever, how many hours, and it's like, it does need to be clear days. So maybe that would be something I should edit on the official use part, is putting it right out there, like what these timelines are. Like I have this 90-day review period terminating, right? Because if the board doesn't review an application in 90 days, the applicant is no longer obligated to wait. They kind of get it, no matter what. So gives you enough time for some sick people in a snowstorm or something, but like. And then the other thing that this other application does not have is a clear set of prices. And what that inevitably ends up happening is the thing is completed and there's this like really ambiguous surveyor like asking, well, should I pay you now or should I pay you later? Or like, and you, it's not Sue's fault at all, but if she receives an application and it's not clear how much they owe, she's just going to say pay the board when you get to there. And it's like, if you have the amounts clear, it is in a statute that the stuff is due up front and is the burden of the applicant. There is a lot of towns that charge real money for this stuff. I don't think we should. The only curve, I mean, everything is rounded up just a little bit so that you know, there's like a little bumper for inflation, like, and there's a little, you know, like a letter. What's a letter plus a stamp cost now together? Like 80 cents or something? It's like a dollar, like whatever, you know? hearing notification is the one that is gonna get us, because sometimes, yeah, it's $50 to get it in the newspaper in the legal section. And sometimes it's like $45, but I've also seen it be like $16. And there's no real way of knowing. It's more often than not 50, so I don't know. I mean, I don't think it's an excessive request. I mean, the person who's having this land subdivided is paying a surveyor like thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's kind of like, to a certain extent, I'm not trying to like charge a fee to like make the board money. That's not really the intent. It's just to make sure that our behind is covered. Like, it shouldn't cost the taxpayers money to have subdivisions done for other people.
You have to price risk this.
I think so.
That's just rule of thumb. That's what you have to do.
And I'm sure there is a case where it would be worse, but like rare enough that I feel like the $16 ones would compensate, and
right.
It just makes it happen right off the bat. And so everything is done. So, and then these minimum requirements that are like so elaborately laid out in the existing application, they are all subject to appeal. Like, if you don't have 200 feet of road frontage, the board looks at it and maybe it's a right-of-way that goes to a property in the back and it's only 50 feet, and like, that might be something that's just fine. But I think those are like the rough guidelines of the ideal. My tendency would be to go for something shorter and simpler so that it's not confusing for everybody involved.
So basically, you're taking a long, complicated thing and made two simple ones.
Yes.
Right, and each one is about half the length.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that there's two of them,
mm-hmm.
but because the two processes are different enough,
okay.
Yeah, it makes it a little bit more laid out rather than wondering how to fill it out. It's kind of maybe slightly more in the direction of foolproof. So, I don't know if you guys have any suggestions on something to change. It definitely would be open to any of that. And I'm not expecting us to vote on this tonight.
Well, let's go over the plan. On page 3 of 3, each one.
Yeah.
Well, especially the. Hold on. What is this? Lot line adjustment applications. More space for comments and less space down at the bottom where there's a waste of space.
Totally, like, because there might be some. No, that's legit.
And maybe a little here, you know.
Yeah.
On the other one, you probably don't need as much things.
Spaces here to like gain us another, like the fees paid doesn't need quite as much space.
No, it's a flat rate.
So it's like, right, it's just a one liner, so.
Just if you're gonna rip off a million of them, better have it, not have it.
Yeah, yeah. The other thing that I think we should talk about as a more complete board and maybe with a little bit more background research is specifically the difference between major and minor subdivision. And why the hell it matters. And I know some of the basics are that if you are dividing a lot into no more than three lots. And I believe if the lots are 5 acres or larger, then it counts as a minor subdivision. And I believe if you are doing more lots or dropping it to a certain acreage, or also the road frontage is expected to be under 200 feet for some reason or another, it becomes a major. I think these terms are like kind of intended for places like Nashua. And I don't really know why if someone could offer a good example of why we need to differentiate so much, I'd be open to it. And I think it's just a matter of habit and tradition, but I don't know.
You may not have an option.
Right, there's probably an RSA suggesting that a minor is this or that. And
right, they may not be optional. So.
Right.
But if it is optional.
Right, and so maybe
that can go away.
If it's not optional, I should probably clarify the reasons that it would be allowed to be minor. If it's certain number of lots are smaller, certain lot size are bigger, plenty of road frontage, like what else would be needed to constitute a minor? I think that's kind of how it is that like a minor has a few catches that you have to follow through, and that a major is anything other than something that applies that all
yeah,
that applies
to. Cut your eye to a major is got a story with it.
Right. It's a little funny to have the property owner listed twice here, but I guess it's good to have the owner map and lot number all on the line there. So that's about all I think that we should probably try to peck away at, considering our attendance. I know that we talked about doing sections 1 through 6, and considering some of the exemptions, which may or may not all make sense, but maybe it makes sense to wait.
Why is this huge? Does anybody know why this big trailer park is in here?
I know, it's like such a big section.
Somebody who just pulled in might know something about it.
It's half the size of half the application.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And it's not even an ordinance.
Right. Come on. Hey, Brian.
Well,
you are arriving at a valuable time.
It may be the
time to close the meeting down. That would be the most valuable time.
We're good if you didn't show up.
Oh, I'll leave.
So, we're looking at the application. I mean, you remember this like half-ass application that I came up with that Frank spit on, and you were like, "Why do we need another application?" And we're looking at it, and it's like, try to refine it a little bit, make it clearer, make it less convoluted, make it less chaotic. But the key of the existing application is the trailer park suggested ordinance.
I don't think that's legal.
That's what we thought.
Just drop it off there because it doesn't belong there. And it never was in there. I've never seen that until the new board.
Right.
That's the God's honest truth.
No. I think that it seems to me like if someone wanted to make a trailer park, they could hire a surveyor to make it a certain way and ensure that like a septic was installed that was capable of handling however many trailers
the
they had.
State covers all that.
Yeah, so it's like I don't think it's really our business to say people can't live in trailers close to one another. I don't know. Does that ring to you?
It says it right here. Experience has shown that an unfair tax card is placed by the people that will be moving into a quote-unquote trailer park. I think that they're anticipating that it's going to swing a tax base with a lot of kids and a lot of...
For sure.
A lot of...
That's
it's going to just throw the population base way off.
It's a complex topic, right?
But be that as it may, the bottom line is it was proposed and voted down, or it was proposed and never voted on.
I don't even think it was, I don't even ever remember it in 20 years. Ever I think it was added somehow. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but there have been a lot of people in and out of the town offices that want more regulations that keep sliding this in and hoping it goes, it gets adopted somehow.
Yeah, you can't present a document like this claiming it's an ordinance and in the very first sentence say it's a proposed ordinance.
Right.
Either it's an ordinance or it's not. And if it's clear,
it was never voted on in the 20 years that I was on the board. Yeah. And frankly, I've never seen it.
It's been present ever since I've been on the board.
Maybe we didn't have an application that was controversial because I don't recall it.
Yeah, I've never seen it otherwise.
I will find out if there is, before we make a decision, something stupid, I will find out if there is an ordinance.
There are two...
From the sounds of it, there isn't, but before we throw it away and then find out there is one after the fact, I'll find out before the fact for sure. Dump it.
Now that I'm thinking about this, I feel like sometime early on in my involvement in the planning board, like, you know, 5 or 6 years ago or whatever, I was trying to get to the bottom of what the application was, and Sue said, do you want the one from 2011 or the one from 2012? And I think I may have gotten both of those at one point, and maybe if she still has them, we could get to the bottom of it. Maybe one of them does not have the trailer park clause. There's all sorts of discussion on regressive or progressive taxation via property tax only, but I kind of like it. It's like, if you don't see the filthy rich people living in trailers, like, you know, they're living in a fancy house and pay $15,000 a year in property tax. It's like, I don't know. You don't want to pay it, like, you know, you know how to manipulate it, like, live somewhere cheap.
I can understand the concept, but I don't think it's a concept that in this day and age you could put before anybody and pull it off. Because what you're basically saying, as much as I hate to say it, is we don't want a trailer park because we don't want a certain type of people in town. And you're not going to get away with that.
Yeah. Tom, do you have anything worth mentioning from the select board?
The select board has been burning bigger fish. So.
Is this like the Johnny Dodge style stuff? Or is there a bigger fish than that?
No, there's just been a lot of other stuff going on. You know, Johnny Dodge really didn't involve us. That was more of a civil legal matter.
And he got his property, right?
He's done. That's it. Right, he signed off on it.
Contributing? Could you tell us your names?
I'm Robert Forshey. I live on 89th Street in Brampton.
Right on.
I'm Sharon Forshey.
Great. All right.
Just specifically, did you have something on your mind?
Well, I wanted to know what trouble you guys are cooking up. Just wanted to hear.
Yeah. I don't know.
This is a quiet board.
Yeah.
It may not always be.
No, it may not always be. No, we have a rough goal of revising some things that have not been revised in a long time. And personally, my goal is to make them clearer and less subject to chaos. Not necessarily like adding any realistic level of regulation. Just making sure that things are documented well. It's not easy to avoid documenting things, and making sure that neighbors are allowed to contribute to clarifying what's happening if there's anything controversial. So
does that mean neighbors are allowed to do what?
Well, so I don't need to beat any dead horses for those that have been watching the horse be beaten. The idea of someone performing a subdivision, there's a legal requirement for the abutters, the abutting property owners to be made aware of what's happening, so that mistakes, and I always say it this way, mistakes, malicious or
unintentional,
or like, you know, just like a harmless mistake. Any mistakes can be brought to the attention so that things are done right. There's so many border controversies and survey overlaps, and this is my pin, no, that's your pin, like, oh, this tree's on my property, no, it's not. And just to provide a central forum for when land is being worked on, that anyone who is involved can present factual information to support what we're trying to accomplish. In other words, if someone wants to subdivide their property and it turns out that their land is not surveyed correctly, we'd like to be able to make sure that a licensed surveyor has surveyed their property so that it's done accurately. And so that nobody else's property rights are infringed upon. So that's the trouble we're getting in.
Nobody's doing title insurance?
I think title insurance is kind of the purchaser's responsibility, right? Is that not?
Yeah, but they demand that everything be demarcated.
But that's on them. That's a separate. That's on that.
Yeah, I know. So, I mean, if people are taking care of their own problems, you don't need to worry about it.
You do. Because they don't always take care of their own problems correctly.
What?
They don't always take care of their own problems correctly.
What are you concerned about that for?
Okay, I'll toss this out here. I bought the auto salvage yacht down on Route 4 from Buddy McDowell 4 years ago. It was 5 properties. They had met lot line adjustments, annexations, purchase and sales, whatnot. Had never, since 1964 was the original purchase, was never consolidated into one property. Had been mortgaged a couple times, title insurance, all of that. I went to buy it. My attorney found that the very first property that was purchased, the demarcation was actually in the back of the church parking lot. 2.5 acres of the property that I was purchasing was 500 yards offside.
Yeah, but you don't have to buy it. It's not all.
But it managed to go.
Sell.
It managed to go 40 years.
So what?
Without anybody. So what?
As long as, the original owner's got it, it's his.
What if someone had built a house on it?
What if somebody had built a house on it? What if the church didn't want to give it up?
It gets complicated.
Because, and when it gets to court, it goes back to who owns it, and they'll just take it away.
And what about everything I lost from the ER I put up getting the job done?
Because you have to be buyer beware. It's not up to the government to protect everybody.
This is not a libertarian forum. This is the Grafton, New Hampshire Planning Board.
There are laws that supersede this board on it. A lot of this is regulated by the state. Brian knows a lot of them better than I do, but a lot of it's regulated by the state. That deed that he had that was signed off